Hello students, in my last class of Merchant of Venice, I have just started Act 1, Scene 2, and it was in Belmont, a room in Portia's house, and we were here too, on my last class, okay? So, Cottage Prince's Palace 6, it was Portia's dialogue. It is a good divine, so let's start. It is a good divine that follows his own instructions. I can easier teach 20 what were good to be done then be one of the 20 to follow mine own teaching. The brain may devise laws for the blood, but a hot temper leaps over a cold decree. Such a hair is madness the youth to skip over the meshes of good counsel the cripple. But this reasoning is not in the fashion to choose me a husband. So she is just discussing her odds, her oddities of life. She is saying that anyone can more easily give good advice to 20 people than be one of these 20 and act upon that same good advice. Man's reason may frame an excellent code of conduct to keep his passion in check. But it is good to utter, but not too good to follow. But a young man of a hot spirit disregards the law laid down by cold reason. In one's youth, one is rash and ignores good advice. And often we notice that the young blood not always follow the things that is told by the old persons. So good advice cannot keep pace with the fast steps of a rash young man. A rash young man is like a fast running hare which leaps over the net laid to trap it. But Portia is saying that her moralizing like this cannot lead her to the choice of a husband. And the word choice is very much critical to her, very much hard to her, because she had no wish of her own. She can't choose anyone of her own wish. She had to take the person who will choose the right casket. So, I would not refuse who I dislike. So is the will of a living daughter curbed by the will of a dead father. So, she was a little bit disturbed minded, and she was not happy with the will of her father too, because she is telling that her destiny is curbed by her father, who is dead, who is not going to leave the life. The life is going to leave by the daughter, that is Portia, and she cannot choose her life according to her own wish. So it is not hard, Nerissa, that I cannot choose one nor refuse none. So it is very much hard for her that she can't choose anyone of her own wish. And she was not able to refuse the person who will choose the casket, if she even didn't like the person or not. Okay. Now next, Nerissa, who is trying to console Portia. Your father was ever virtuous, and holy men at their death have good inspirations. So she is trying to console the lady. She's saying that your father was a very wise person, and holy men and wise person, when they are going to die and at the time of death, they tell or do whatever is very much good and appropriate for us. Therefore, the lottery that he hath devised in these three chests of gold, silver, and lead, whereof who chooses meaning choose you, will no doubt never be chosen by any rightly, but one who you shall rightly love. But what warmth is there in your affection towards any of these princely suitors that are already come? So, she was telling that if someone is able to choose the right casket, and if someone is taking part in the competition, that means he is the person is very much passionate to you. That is why he is entering the competition, and there is no question of his love, because he loves you, and then he enter into the competition. Okay, and that is the reason that you have no doubt about the love of that person. He certainly loves you. That is why he entered into the competition. Because if the person lose, if the person lose the competition, then he had to go empty-handed, and he will not be allowed to marry in his life anymore. So a person who is going to enter the competition willingly, that means he know the truth, and it is no question about his love, that he loves you very much. And if he able to choose a casket, proper casket, then he is a wise man too, and who will be able to manage all your property and your dress all together. So it will be good for you. So, but what warmth is there in your affection towards any of these princely suitors that are already come? So some suitors had already come, and they are going to take part in the competition. It is not confirmed that they are going to take part in it or not, but somebody has some princes and barons and lords, they have come to enter into the competition. So do you have any kind of affection towards any one of them? So please tell me. Nerissa wanted to know. Then Portia is telling, I pray thee over name them. You please name them one by one, and I will discuss that, I will describe them rather, and by my description you will be able to understand that what is my affection towards those persons, isn't it? And as thou namest them, I will describe them, and according to my description level at my affection, so as I have told you. Okay, now Nerissa, first there is the Neapolitan prince. So a prince who had come from Neapolitan, okay, so he is called the Neapolitan prince. So Portia is telling about Neapolitan prince. Hey, that's a colt indeed. Colt, you know, colt is a baby horse, baby male horse. A baby male horse is called a colt. Hey, that's a colt indeed, for he doth nothing but talk of his horse, and he makes it a great appropriation to his own good parts, that he can shew him himself. I am much afraid, my lady, his mother played false with a smith. So yes, truly speaking, he is a foolish guy, a young fellow, like a young horse. He always hops and skips and like that, because he does nothing except he like to talk about his horse, and he considers that he can shoe his horse himself. I certainly have a suspicion that his mother had an illicit love affair with a blacksmith, and that he was born of that illicit union, and that he has inherited the ability to shoe a horse from his blacksmith father. What is the work of a blacksmith? He can shoe the horse. Okay, that is, he can nail the horse. So Portia has a very bad feeling about the Neapolitan prince, who had no personality at all. So Nerissa, then there is the county palatine. Now they are talking about the county palatine. This is the second one. So Portia is saying that he doth nothing but frown. Is very much sad person. Always he pretend to be very sad and thinking about nothing, or always like to that he is going to cry or like that. As who should say, and you will not have me choose. He hears merry tales and smiles not. I fear he will prove the weeping philosopher when he grows old, being so full of unmannerly sadness in his youth. I had rather be married to a death's head with a bone in his mouth than to either of these. God defend me from these two. So Portia is not willing to marry this two person, with any of these two person, because they have different kind of personalities, and that Portia did not like at all. So about County Palatine, she is telling that he does nothing except wear an expression of irritation on his face. He's irritated. He felt irritated at everything. The expression on his face seems to mean that if I do not marry him, he cares little whom I marry. He hears funny stories, but he does not smile, not feel amused at all. I'm afraid that in his old age, he will behave like a weeping philosopher. A philosopher who thinks a lot, and along with that, he will be a weeping philosopher because he is so full of unbecoming sadness in his youth. A person who is so young, he should not be so sad. I would rather marry a skull with a bone in its mouth. That is the sign of a danger, you know that. Either of these. So I don't want to marry anyone with these two person. May God save me from these two suitors. So Nerissa, how say you by the French Lord Monsieur Le Bon? Monsieur Le Bon's a French one. So God made him, and therefore Portia is telling, God made him and therefore let him pass for a man. A truth I know, it is a sin to be a mocker. But why he hath a horse better than the Napolitans, a better bad habit of frowning than the County Palatine. He is every man in no man. If a throstle sing, he falls straight a capering. He will faints with his shadow. If I should marry him, I should marry 20 husbands. So this person has kind of split personalities. Is a example of different kinds of personalities he had. If he would despise me, I would forgive him. For if he love me to madness, I shall never requite him. So Portia is telling about Monsieur Le Bon that as God created him, let be accepted as a man. Indeed, I know that it is a sin to make fun of others, because we all know that if we mock at anyone, someone will mock on us too. That is true. So Portia is very much honest here. So she is saying that what a strange fellow he is. Really, he has a horse better than the one belonging to the Napolitan prince, and he has a worse habit of looking irritated than the Count Palatine. He behaves like everybody else, but has no individual of character of his own. So he don't have any distinct personality of his own. If a thrush, that is a bird, sings, throstle means thrush. Thrush is a kind of bird. Thrush were to sing, start singing, he would immediately start dancing, or he would dance whoever calls that tune, even if it were a thrush singing or not. He is so ridiculous that he will start measuring swords with his own shadow. So he's a fool. By marrying him, I would be marrying 20 different persons, because he is a combination of 20 persons and one person. So it is almost impossible for Portia to marry this kind of person. So Nerissa is telling, what say you thee to Falcon Bridge, the young Baron of England? So this person is quite good a person, but there is a problem of Portia that she could not speak English. You know, I say nothing to him, for he understands. Not me, nor I him. He hath neither Latin, French, nor Italian, and you will come into the court and swear that I have a poor pennyworth in the English. He is a proper man's picture, but alas, who can converse with a dumb show? How oddly he is fitted. I think he bought his doublet in Italy, his round hose in France, his bonnet in Germany, and his behavior everywhere. So here Portia is trying to tell that he don't understand English. Okay, and my language, and I do not understand his own language. And he neither understand Latin, French, or Italian. Those I have some knowledge about that. As for me, I have a very poor knowledge of the English language, a fact to which you will bear testimony on oath in a court of law. And you can take oath on it that I don't know this English language. He is certainly a handsome fellow. Alas, it is not possible to have conversation with a man who does not know my language and whose language I do not understand. how strange his clothes are. I think he bought his jacket in Italy, his breeches in France, his hat in Germany. So he's looking very ridiculous. His dress sense is very poor, while his behavior in a mixture of the manners that he has witnessed in different countries. So he has no distinct personality. Okay, so Neri-san, what is she trying to tell Portia? What think you of Scottish lord, his neighbor? So the Scottish lord is called the neighbor of the English baron. So why he is called so? Because we all know, according to the map of our world, we know that Scotland is the neighboring country of England. So that is why the Scottish lord has been quite appropriately called the neighbor of the English baron. So Portia is telling that he hath a neighborly charity in him, for he borrowed a box of the ear of the Englishman, and swore he would pay him again when he was able. I think the Frenchman become his surety and sealed under for another. So Portia is thinking that he has a kind and forgiving disposition, because when he was hit on the ear by the Englishman, he instead of hitting back immediately, promised on an oath that he would hit him back when he was in a position to do so. So he wants to take the revenge. I think that the Frenchman stood surety for the Scottish lord and signed a bond for another box on the ear. So they have signed a treaty like that. So Neri-sa, how like you the young German, the Duke of Saxony's nephew? So what is your idea about the Duke of German? So Portia is telling, very wildly in the morning when he is sober, and most wildly in the afternoon when he is drunk. When he is best, he is a little better than a man, and when he is worst, he is a little better than a beast. And the worst fall that ever fell, I hope I shall make shift to go without him. So Portia is telling, I have a very low opinion about him in the morning when he is not drunk. So he's a drunkard, and I have the lowest possible opinion about him in the afternoon when he is drunk. He falls his short of being man even when he is at his best, and at his worst he is hardly better than a beast. So there is no comparison with man like him. Even if the worst happens, I hope I shall manage to go without him. I don't want to mention anything about him, because I just consider him as a beast. So Neri-sa is telling, if he should offer to choose and choose the right casket, you should refuse to perform your father's will, if you should refuse to accept him. So Neri-sa is telling that if the German succeeded to choose the proper casket, then what will you do? You will refuse to marry him. And then if you refuse to marry him, then you have to, that means that you are refusing your father's will. So what will you do? So Portia is telling about a trick to Neri-sa. She's telling that, therefore, for fear of the worst, I pray thee, set a deep glass of Rhenish wine on the contrary casket. Please place a Rhenish wine glass in the contrary casket, that means on a casket in which my portrait is not there, and he will be attracted by the smell of the wine, and he will choose the wrong casket. For if the devil be within and that temptation without, I know he will choose it. I will do anything, Neri-sa, here. I will be married to a sponge. So I can do anything for that. I don't want to marry a drunkard, a sponge that is a drunkard. So Neri-sa is telling, you need not fear, lady, the having any of these lords. They have acquainted me with their determinations, which is indeed to return to their home and trouble you with no more sweet. unless you may be won by some other sort than your father's imposition, depending on the casket. So you need not to fear about this anymore, because these persons decided, they had decided that they will going home back. They are not going to take part in the competition. They are afraid. So our today our class ends here. You please mark on this line. Okay, I will start from next part from here in our next class. Okay, thank you.